honored to be asked to speak to so many people that I know here and have worked with over time, whether directly or indirectly. There's a lot of the names I know. I'd also like to acknowledge that two of my students are now working with us, the ones from the University of Cincinnati, and they're here in the audience. Stacia Grove and Jessica Chung are our nurse practitioners. One thing, Dr. Rea, nurse practitioners don't always prescribe, I promise. In our crowd, you'd have a hard time getting us to medicate somebody with a dementia behavior. We really do try to work it out ahead of time. Against great odds, I might add, in the acute care setting. These are just the objectives. We're going to touch on the workup of an older adult with some cognitive impairment, the causes of cognitive impairment, non-pharmacologic interventions, normal physiologic changes affecting the pharmacodynamics and pharmacokinetics of the older adult, and the differences among delirium, dementia, and depression, only because that's an ongoing issue that we face in the acute care setting. So when we're talking about delirium, dementia, and depression, okay, when a person has a cognitive impairment, it's really important to figure this out. Because many times, especially in the hospital, the issue is not always pure dementia or a change in their dementia behavior. It is more that they now have a superimposed delirium. But again, the dementia behaviors are still very difficult to deal with when we have such a short time with the patient, and they can all run together as well. People with dementia are much more susceptible to becoming delirious, and those who are in the early stages of dementia are very susceptible to depression. Depression actually used to be called pseudo-dementia in the olden days. Patients with pseudo-dementia show significantly greater pretreatment, early morning wakening, higher ratings of psychological anxiety, which feeds into some of the earlier talks you had, and more impairment of libido. Patients with dementia showed significantly more disorientation to time, greater difficulty finding their way around familiar streets or indoors, and more impairment with activities of daily living, especially with dressing. And then you have in your slides an overview of how you would differentiate. Depression comes on over weeks to months. Delirium can be hours to days, but it can be as many as 30 days or a month. We had one lady recently that who was actually quite young by our standards. She was only 73. And she came in because she had stopped eating and became quite ill. She had a very high sodium level when she arrived at the hospital. Her family brought her in for behavior changes. She had actually been seen by another physician at her home other than her primary care physician, and he had changed many, many of her medications around. The family, when we did a detailed history, reported the shorter time frame as opposed to this lady had some chronic illness that affected her over time. And indeed, this lady probably had mild cognitive impairment by the time she was done. We found that she had a stricture of her distal esophagus. It was dilated. She started eating again. All her numbers corrected, and she cleared right up. And instead of placing her, they took her home. So that was a save. Dementia, on the other hand, develops over months to years. And it's chronic. It has deterioration over time. Dementia is a terminal disease. And that's something that many people don't consider when we're talking about the care of our older adults. Initially, depending on the time of the type of dementia the person has, dementia is a big, broad umbrella. And underneath it, it's like saying you have an infection. And you could have a common cold, or you could have gangrene of the foot. Dementia is a huge umbrella also. And it has Alzheimer's dementia, frontotemporal dementia, Parkinson's dementia. The list literally goes on and on and on. And that's actually a whole day's lecture. But the reason I'm pointing this out is sometimes dementia patients can have personality changes without the prominent forgetfulness, especially if they have like a frontotemporal dementia, which we do encounter pretty frequently at the hospital with the patients who come in with the most behavioral issues and changes in mental status. From the Alzheimer's Association website, to give them credit, 5.4 million Americans have Alzheimer's disease. 40% of life expectancy is spent in the severe stage from diagnosis on. The number of deaths from Alzheimer's is up 66% since 2000, and it doubles every 5 years after the age of 65. If you have a family history of it, your risk is even higher. 5 to 10% of individuals in the community that are over 70 suffer from dementia, but when you get over 85, it goes up to 45 to 50%. Medicare, Medicaid, private insurance, and out-of-pocket expenses for medical care are estimated at $183 billion. And I honestly don't even think it captures the informal care and the informal caregivers that are out in the community caring for these patients. Women, which is over half this room, are at the epicenter of the Alzheimer's crisis. Our lifetime risk is 1 in 5, compared with men's risk of being 1 in 11. So gender alone protects you. There is a certain amount of just the numbers of us that will be around as we get older, but this has been corrected in this particular study. And just as a comparison, not to minimize the disease of breast cancer, but as real a concern as that is to women's health, women age 60 are twice as likely to develop Alzheimer's disease over the course of their life as they are to have breast cancer. So it's a bigger issue, a very big issue. So let's start at the beginning. If you want to stop dementia, or at least slow it down, the key thing that has been clearly documented in the studies as most helpful is a healthy lifestyle, and especially one that is kind of a heart-healthy lifestyle. Lowering cholesterol, lowering blood pressure, keeping blood sugar levels normal, insulin levels normal, keeping obesity under control, staying physically active, and then, of course, no smoking. That's an always. This lady in the picture, by the way, was in the Washington Post at one point. She, I believe, was 91 years old. She was very close to 90 if she wasn't. I have a number of pictures of different people in here. So what are the guidelines for activity? They're really the same as they are for anybody, but for seniors, they do have them outlined a little bit more clearly. Aerobic exercise, resistance exercise, flexibility exercise, and balance exercise. And there's a variety of ways that these can be incorporated into your normal day. And it is never too late to start some activity. If you have somebody who is completely inactive, they will benefit, no matter how old they are, from some movement and motivation and mobility. So what is dementia? And I know we've probably talked about this today a lot, but it's not a specific disease, and that's what I was alluding to when I gave you my umbrella analogy. It's an overall term that describes a wide range of symptoms associated with a decline in memory or other thinking skills, and it's severe enough to reduce a person's ability to perform everyday tasks. And that's one of the key pieces that I encounter when families come to me either by phone or when we have their family member in the hospital, or we have somebody else in the hospital and they find out you're geriatrics and they just want to chat about it, is the feeling that if someone has any degree of memory impairment, they have a dementia. To have a diagnosis of dementia, you have to have a deficit in your activities of daily living. You have to be impaired in your activities of daily living. Otherwise, what do you have? I know somebody in the room knows it. You have mild cognitive impairment, that's correct. Now, of those mild cognitive impairment patients, about 10% per year will go on to develop a dementia. But at this point, the research isn't giving us clear guidance on who is going to progress and who is not, which means that 90% of those individuals overall in any given year will die with their mild cognitive dementia and no further progression. But that is a big difference that we need to account for. Vascular dementia, which occurs often after a stroke, is the second most common dementia type. And there are many conditions that can cause the symptoms of dementia that are correctable. So part of what we talk about whenever we're seeing a patient that's been diagnosed with a cognitive impairment or a mental status change is, what are the things that we could possibly fix that we can improve that might make this person's life better and make their functioning better, right? Now, vascular dementia, I would also put a caveat on, is it can occur in the face of chronic diabetes, even a single stroke, and develop as more of microscopic strokes going throughout the brain especially. Dementia is known by many misnomers, senility, senile dementia, chronic senile impairment, the list goes on and on and on. When we were doing a study on delirium at one point, overall, for any kind of confusion, we found 164 different things in the diagnostic codes that we pulled as possibly being dementia or delirium. So let's talk about what the symptoms look like. Amnesia, repeating yourself, losing things, frustrated and getting paranoid. Those are the other things that people may complain about more. The person may be having very subtle signs of forgetting things, losing things, misplacing things, putting them very safely away, never to be found again. But what the person that's caring for them or lives with them may see is more severe frustration. And it may be a degree of paranoia of, somebody took my things, because I know I'd remember where they were. Apraxia, that's the inability to, it's a movement disorder. So it's the inability to eat, to use utensils, to toilet. And what those patients become is won't eat, and I apologize if I'm offending anybody using patients. I have patients at the hospital, and I try when I go to the nursing homes to remember their residents, but and they may be incontinent. I can't tell you the number of, over the years, spouses, usually it's a wife, who has said, you know what he's doing now? He's peeing in my potted plant. He always hated that plant. But in reality, it goes back to he's mistaking it for something different or he's not able to find the bathroom. But it really takes a lot for some of these wives. You really wonder what they've gone through in their life because they're so angry at the husband peeing in the potted plant. Agnosia is a symptom where people can't recognize people or objects. These individuals may take things, may be frightened or combative, may deny their impairment very commonly because no one wants to be impaired. Aphasia can be expressive. In other words, you know what you want to say, but you can't get it out. Receptive is when you're hearing the words and you're hearing them correctly, but the meaning isn't getting there. And then you can have a mixed aphasia. I've had patients that have had all of these, and I think of one, Mr. Westbrook in particular, who has told me I can use him in any of my talks, and how he had a bad stroke, but really his only residual was his aphasia. And he was able to communicate to us using the computer and writing how frustrating this was. This was Colonel Westbrook. He was career Army, and he used to lead his reunion group from West Point, and it was very, very frustrating for him. Executive function may decline. These are individuals who aren't going to be able to do more advanced thinking, thinking that has multiple steps to it. They're not going to be able to perhaps cook, balance a checkbook. They may not be able to make decisions. So what they look like is they look stubborn. They look disorganized. But in reality, they're working as hard as they can at holding things together. There are considered to be reversible causes of dementia. In reality, we've always called them that, but in reality, I would call them different diseases that can mimic a dementia. And the workup should include all of these things. Not all of them are reversible. HIV dementia, Creutzfeldt-Jakob, BSE are not reversible. Patients with potentially reversible causes of dementia don't necessarily get better once the underlying condition is treated or corrected. Probably the most blatant example, and I put the x-ray here so that it would remind me, is patients who have been diagnosed with normal pressure hydrocephalus. Many of those patients, although we fix the normal pressure hydrocephalus with a shunt, or they do a spinal tap to assess if the shunt would be useful for them, they don't necessarily regain lost function, but it does seem to progress. So if you can identify it early enough, you could have somebody that's, you know, in what we would call the mild stages of dementia and can continue to function. Other neurological conditions such as seizures, traumatic encephalopathy, mental retardation, they're not considered dementia because they're more stable. However, one example though is that patients that have mental retardation, especially Down syndrome, trisomy 21, are at risk for very early dementia of the Alzheimer's sort. They also are at high risk for intractable seizures. At the hospital, we have a group of young people who are working in kind of a workshop setting in various tasks at the hospital. And one of those we had was a young man who died at 58 after developing dementia. He had trisomy 21. He worked at the hospital for about 15 years. Everybody knew him, and he was a good influence on all of us. Hypothyroidism can easily, it's a quick, cheap test, and it's easily corrected. It's a quick, cheap fix. Alcoholism, if treated, can also have a significant amount of recovery in brain function. any drug toxicity. We did have a patient this past week who, she was she's another young one. We've had a lot of young ones this week. Most of my patients are 90 and up, and we've had a lot of 70 and 80 year olds. She is in her mid 70s, and she had a massive stroke about a year ago now. Her embolic stroke converted to a hemorrhagic stroke. And since that time, she's had multiple episodes of aspiration pneumonia. She's had urinary tract infections. She also now has gone into renal failure and is going to be an ongoing dialysis patient. She, the other day, because she came in this last time with status epilepticus, is essentially Dilantin level. Forgive my not using the chemical terms, was about not very far above therapeutic. Normal is 10 to 20, and hers was 22. But she became quite somnolent, and when we addressed that and treated it, she improved dramatically. A vasculitis can also cause a dementia, and that can be easily treated with steroids. Okay. Touched on most of these. So what we're talking about here with the workup, for a CBC, we're looking for somebody to have a delirium or some kind of an inflammatory process caused by infection. A chemistry panel, liver function tests can be worked on and corrected, and those can improve the cognition. Glucose level. B12 can cause pernicious anemia. It can cause peripheral neuropathies as well as cognitive impairment. The thyroid we talked about. The SED rate indicates inflammation and can be an indicator of vasculitis, which if treated can improve dramatically. CT and an MRI of the head, you have to base that on what you're seeing and what the clinical picture is. It's not needed for everybody, and in fact, we joke that everybody who walks through our emergency room, no matter what their diagnosis or how long they've had it, they get their head scanned if they're confused at all, even if they came from the locked unit of Arden Courts, which is a Alzheimer's dementia care unit. The American Academy of Neurological Practice parameter from 2001 on the workup of dementia suggests that we should all assess each time we're seeing a patient vascular risk factors, any history of neurological disease, head trauma, medications, and a family history. Screen for depression. Depression can be a mimicking of dementia. It really can, and it is treatable in most cases. A physical exam to look for sensory deficits, orthostatic hypotension, and a focal neuro findings. Lab screenings. You don't need to do an RPR unless the patient is in a high-risk group, but if there's any doubt in your mind at all, what are we looking for with an RPR? Tertiary syphilis, yeah. And I actually had, I've had three gentlemen come back with positive RPRs in the last few years. One asked me to speak to his daughter, who was chief of geriatrics at a facility in the United States, and she actually pointed out to me that we needed to do the next level of testing because dad had actually gone to indoctrinate her nephew to the ways of the world because he thought he was delayed, and the two of them probably had primary. You can do drug screening, drug levels, digoxin toxicity, like the Dilantin toxicity, can cause impairment, and HIV testing. Minimal cognitive impairment, I broached on. It's cognitive decline in one sphere only, and it's usually memory. There usually is no functional disability, and the individual maintains the ability to function in the world. They have no deficits in their ADLs. They may have some deficits in areas that are the IADLs, but those are not considered diagnostic for dementia. They usually have no change in language, executive function, agnosia, apraxia, no change in their personality or the attention ability. It does, however, have an increased risk of mortality of 5 years, within 5 years, 33% increased. And there is some progression to dementia within 5 years. Right. It's been fairly poorly characterized. This is what people seem to call benign senile or senescent forgetfulness, age-associated memory impairment, and age-associated cognitive decline. But in reality, it is its own entity, and it bears defining, because hopefully at some point we'll be able to figure out who the individuals are that are going to progress to dementia. So how are we going to assess these patients? We're going to test them. Instead of bringing you handouts of every single test, what I did was I put together a one-page handout that has the websites where you can access each of the individual tests. And at the bottom, you will also find two, I think, kind of helpful programs. One is the Alzheimer's Safe Return Program for patients. The other one is the Sheriff's Program that essentially involves putting a GPS on people who wander off and you're trying to keep at home as long as possible. CMS and the National Institute on Aging did convene a panel about 5 years ago to review the screening tests for multiple degrees of cognitive impairment. And they reviewed 144 different instruments, and they really were unable to really tease out a single instrument which was most useful. What you need to do is to look at the time to administer, the cost overall, the population, and the diversity. And just so you know, the American Neurological Association makes no recommendation and purposely did not recommend routine screening for the onset of dementia because we don't have a whole lot to offer those individuals. Just to look at the different tests, the mini-cog takes about 3 minutes to give. It is much less affected by culture, by education and language. The SLUMS is the St. Louis University Mental Status Exam. It's very similar to the mini-mental status, the Folstein from 1975. The AD8, we'll talk about a little bit in a minute. The 7-minute screen is some quick tests, quick questions, and they're clearly defined. The brief cognitive screen is also the same. The clock drawing test is one where it really tests executive function, higher level functions, because you've got to plan out this clock. And I thought you'd be interested. These are actual patients' drawings that have been done when we've been examining them, doing consults on them. And you can see that bottom one is also a clock drawing submitted. You know, some of the clock drawings are really wild looking. They can look like aliens with three hairs on top of their head, but I thought that was one of the more interesting ones. Clearly the person was in a very happy place. Three-word recall, and then you give the patient three words, have them repeat it, and then at 5 minutes after distractions, you go back to those three words. And then you can do computerized neuropsychological testing or formal neuropsychological testing. We're very lucky, affiliated with George Mason, we have a wonderful group. I don't know their official name, I just know Jeff Wilkin is part of it, and he has a whole team that does a marvelous job on testing our older adults. They also give great talks. They're the ones that give the day-long talks on dementia. The AD8 is a functional screen. It looks at problems with judgment, interest, trouble learning, repetition, orientation, complicated financial affairs, so executive function, and daily problems with thinking and memory. It has a sensitivity in research of 84% and specificity of 80%, and its predictive value is over 85%. The negative predictive value is 70%. Has there been a change in the last several years due to cognitive problems, not physical problems? And 0 to 1 is considered normal, and 2 or more is probably cognitively impaired. All of these are screens. They're not diagnostic, all right? These are screens that there's a problem and that we need to take it to the next step. So how are we going to classify our dementia? The three largest groups are identifiable dementias, progressive dementias, and minimal cognitive impairment. Under progressive dementias are Alzheimer's and vasculars, which you know are the, as we've just talked about, are the most common, Lewy body dementia and frontotemporal dementia. From Lewy body, you can also have Parkinson's dementia, which is a related disorder, and frontotemporal can also be related to Pick's disease. The patients that I find many times are the most misunderstood are those with a frontotemporal or a Lewy body dementia, because those individuals, it tends to occur earlier in life, and those individuals may still be working, and they really are perceived many times as being lazy or not doing their job or not capable. And many of the stories that I've heard from various people, when you look at the frontotemporal association locally and the Lewy body association locally, are those individuals have either used up all of the family's savings or retirement, they've lost their job and have not found one, and they continue to go out to work every day and nobody knows that there's a problem. The wife may think that they're just a little bit, it tends to be men more than women, and the wife may just think, well, he's getting a little cranky, there's something going on, and she doesn't realize he's lost his job. Especially in, I think, this area where we have many, high-level functioning women that are at high levels both in jobs and education. In some areas, the man still takes care of everything, so if they're minding the financial and they're minding the household things, it doesn't come up until too late. There have been people who have lost their jobs and their houses that I know of in this area. So what overall is our primary goal in taking care of these patients? We want to enhance their quality of life any way we can. We want to try and maximize their functional performance. And Dr. Rhea, you talked about not making the person more dependent. There's actually functional nursing out there where we do try and promote self-care and that the patient to do as much as they possibly can and that we don't do for them, but enable them and increase their ability to function independently, hopefully. It's not the norm, I will tell you. We want to improve their cognition, their mood, and behaviors. We want to maintain this individual's dignity, no matter where they are residing, no matter where they end up, or what settings they have to pass through before they get to back home or back to wherever they are, as well as to keep this individual comfortable. If I can point out, this gentleman, the picture in the bottom was a Washington Post article about a gentleman who was 102 years old and felt that he was losing all function, and he went to a trainer at a gym, and he ran a marathon last year. And the lady above was, I forget her story. She was another one of our patients at one point. Her husband brought in a picture to show us, because she looked nothing like that when we saw her. A lot of what we deal with, and this is part of what we've been talking about today throughout this whole program, is the dementia-related behaviors. We probably can't fix the dementia, but what can we do to help fix the behaviors or redirect the behaviors or correct them? And the kinds of things that seem most problematic, especially in acute care, are aggression, agitation, and confusion, and hallucinations. Those individuals, if they are diagnosed with delirium, are likely to get some medication, but they tend to get Ativan or sleeping pills, and we try to educate the healthcare team that these are not the optimal medications, that if the patient truly is delirious, we need to treat the delirium. We need to correct the causes of it, and then we need to treat it if it's interfering with care. But you don't do it by putting the patient to sleep. That isn't the way to go. Wandering is also sometimes an issue on many floors because they don't have the ability to contain people. Heck, we were having trouble containing everything this morning. Other dementia-related behaviors are cognitive impairment. The amnesia, the aphasia, the apraxia, and the agnosia I talked about. These can be very difficult for families to deal with if they are having more trouble communicating with their patient or with their family member, my patient. I can remember the first time my father-in-law put shaving cream all over his toothbrush and started brushing his teeth with it. My mother-in-law just about had a fit, and I said, well, just put the shaving cream out of sight and have the toothpaste right next to his toothbrush or put it on for him. And she tried that, and it worked great, and that was the end of that issue, but it was such an easy fix. You know, people just don't think about that. Everything is out where it always has to be and where it's always been, because that's how it's always been. Individuals that have dementia-related behaviors can also have hallucinations, delusions, mania, anxiety, and depression, and we've talked about some of them today. We do have one lady that's in one of my medical director's practices who has persistent delusions. She has mild cognitive impairment. But if you don't ask her about it, you won't ever know about it, because it just happened to come up one day when she was in the doctor's office, and now the physician knows to, you know, are those men still watching in the backyard? Because there's men watching her in the backyard. They don't look in the window, they don't bother her, they don't do anything else, and it's not disturbing her. So many times people would say, well, how can we treat this? Well, like has been said before, you gotta pick your battles. Are you gonna medicate somebody to, you know, when they're functioning fairly well, to get rid of something that's not bothering them and not bothering anybody else? Depression can be treated, anxiety can be addressed. As can mania. People who have physical symptoms or physical illness in the presence of dementia are going to be more likely to develop delirium. They're going to be more going to have pain, fatigue, and depression. And when they're ill, we're going to see these symptoms more magnified. Environmental behaviors are a major one. Overstimulation, understimulation, too much noise, too much sun, and whoever was standing in front of it, noise, activity, people, whether it be the person's individual characteristics or different characteristics. Caregivers, both professional and family, are kind of uniformly fairly uninformed. And one of the things that I think we all need to work to, and the Alzheimer's Association and groups like this one are working to increase the knowledge of both the, all levels of the community, both the lay community, as it were, as well as our caregiving community. We need to be more flexible. We need to not talk over patients that we know have a cognitive impairment. You still always address the patient. And I have seen occasionally caregivers be rather punishing or threatening to older adults, and that's not tolerated at all. It's stopped immediately. Usually it is a knowledge deficit, hopefully, but it's complete ignorance of what dementia is, and that's what we work very hard to increase the knowledge of all the staff members at the acute care setting. And again, lack of empathetic speech, correcting the patient. No, your mother died years ago. No, your purse isn't anywhere, your son has it. You know, those kinds of things can be very agitating to an individual patient that is confused and now in a very strange place. So who's affected by these behaviors? It's all levels of caregivers, family, formal and informal caregivers. Lots of times the primary care physician does not observe it, they don't see it. The patient manages to pull it together very well while they're in the office setting. And the descriptions that the family gives sometimes can be very vague. It's very hard when somebody's starting to cognitively change to put your finger, if you're not a clinician, on exactly what parts are changing. And the symptoms can be very vague in and of themselves. And then also, after they speak with us, we're not always giving them clear strategies. Just as an example, like putting the red flannel on the door or me telling my mother-in-law to put away the shaving cream until he's ready to shave. We don't always do that. 25% of people accessing acute care hospital services are likely to have dementia at any given time. And the number of patients with dementia is predicted to double in the next 30 years. Many times I teach to our critical care fellowship or our ED fellowship, all the different fellowships we have. And many of them say, well, I can skip this class because I'm not going into geriatrics. I'm going into whatever. And I do point out to them the percentage. I always try and have that number handy of my patients that are in their ED or their OR or their ICU because it's reflective of the general population. And those individuals are going to be seen. And if you can care for them using evidence-based care, it's going to be easier on the caregiver as well as better for the patient and better outcomes. Between 48 to 55% of nursing home residents also suffer from dementia. And they also come to the hospital. So in addition to progressive cognitive loss, almost all Alzheimer's dementia patients eventually do develop some personality changes and significant behavioral challenges. One of the things that I always teach families is that if you can handle it for a little while or we can help you cope with it, in a few weeks or a month, there'll be a different one. This one will be gone and we'll have a new one to deal with and figure out. Mood disorders such as depression is present in the older adult. Behaviors such as restlessness, wandering, agitation, and aggression. Sometimes some psychotic symptoms, including hallucinations and delusions, as we alluded to earlier, can occur with severely disruptive behaviors. These tend to be some of the behaviors that predict placement in long-term care. And probably the one behavior that occurs over and over again when you look at the studies is when patients become unable or attempt to manage their own bowels and they're not capable and no longer continent. That is a big factor in placement for the older adult. I'd say wandering is probably the second most significant factor that's been identified in the research. All caregivers, especially healthcare professionals and the entire healthcare team, should consider behaviors as a means of patient communication. These patients are losing their ability to adequately make their needs known. We need to help them and work with them to help understand what their needs are or to identify them. One of the key ways we can do that in the acute care setting is if something usually hurts, assume it's going to hurt and medicate the patient. Not put them to sleep, just medicate them lightly with some Tylenol to take the edge off if whatever goes on is usually a painful episode. So what are we going to do now to figure out how to care for these patients? And I don't have, the next slide is a good one, but I don't have permission yet to give it out. I'm waiting on a return. This is from one of my niche colleagues in Mercy Health, and they actually put together a whole algorithm for the acute care setting for dementia with behavioral disturbances and how the staff should address it, how they should analyze it, and what they should look for as they're going forward in their care of this patient, especially if the patient is exhibiting some behavior that isn't giving us a clear communication of what their need is. Does anybody have any questions so far? So one of the biggies in the acute care setting is pain. Ask the patient if they're in pain. Lots of times they can tell you, sometimes they can't. But you also need to look for verbal and nonverbal cues. Check the medical history. This is what I was alluding to. If they have something that usually causes pain, it's okay to treat them for it. You don't have to go, as many of my physician colleagues do, for 2 of morphine. You can give a scheduled Tylenol every 8 hours. It will work very nicely. And review the medical history for pain management that was used in the past and if it was effective. The other thing that I always put in as a caveat whenever I'm teaching is, say I know that Mr. Jones, who's 89 years old, has bad arthritis in his hip, and it's awaiting replacement. But he comes up and he tells me, you know, my hip is hurting something awful, or my knee is hurting very terribly today, and it's really bothering me. And many times what I've heard colleagues say is, well, you remember, you have arthritis in your knee. You should never attribute a new pain or a new complaint to an existing disorder without working it up. Okay, you have to work it up. When you have somebody with dementia, there's 2 tools that work very nicely, and you can use it for anybody who can't speak to you as well. The tools are the nonverbal checklist of pain indicators, and the other one is called Pain Ad, and it doesn't stand for anything. This was what they just titled it. There's a copy of Pain Ad right here, and the items it looks at are breathing is in. No vocalizations with breathing, no grunting or groaning, facial expression, body language, and consolability. And these are rated as 0 to 3, so that you can actually judge what the pain is. We chose to use this one because all of our other pain scales are on a score of 1 to 10, and this one was the checklist of nonverbal pain indicators, I believe was on a scale of 1 to 12 or 1 to 8, I don't remember which one. There was something else. Oh, commonly when patients have pain that have dementia, you see people whipping out the pediatric FACES scale. Do you know the one I'm talking about, where it goes from a nice, happy, calm person all the way up to a person in horrible angst, and you want the patient to point to which one? That scale has actually been tested in mild to moderate dementia. It is not a valid or reliable scale. Part of what these individuals are losing is their ability to perceive and interpret facial expressions. You should not use this scale on patients with dementia, please. The individual may have some bladder distension. You want to assess them for abdominal tenderness, suprapubic tenderness. Look at their history. Have they had benign prostatic hypertrophy in the past? Have they had a history of urinary retention in the past? Review the medication history for medications which can affect voiding. Any anticholinergic drug can. Toilet these individuals every 2 hours. That's going to help keep them more comfortable, as well as you're going to reduce your falls because these individuals won't be tearing to the bathroom. Post-void bladder scanning is available in the hospital. Do any of the long-term care facilities have that ability or that technology that are here today? None of the ones I know do. One was talking about getting a bladder scan to assess. It's similar to what they use on pregnant women, an ultrasound type of thing, but you can actually see what the contents of the bladder are. The medications which can be problematic are anticholinergics, antidepressants, and antihistamines. My mother-in-law took Tylenol PM to help her sleep. She doesn't anymore, and she's still not talking to me. Because I told her how bad it was for her brain. She says, I really want it, but I don't want to mess my brain. Bowel can also be an issue. First off, if you have somebody that's becoming agitated, check what their schedule is and have they gone to the bathroom recent times. Determine their bowel patterns. If they have not, or if they're having liquid stool or loose stool, make sure you check them for an impaction. Look at the abdomen, assess them for distension, tenderness, for bowel function. You know, are they developing a small bowel obstruction or an ileus? Look at their medication history and review their history for previous constipation, impaction, or any change in mobility or effect from medications. There is a cocktail that we have used in home care for patients who have some bowel function problems. I've never been able to get it into any of the facilities or into the hospital. It consists of one part bran, one part applesauce, and one part prunes. If you have somebody at home, put it in a canister, screw the top on, and it keeps for 30 days quite safely in the fridge. And what you do is give spoonfuls until desired results achieved daily. And you can get to the patient to the point where you can just give them two spoonfuls at breakfast, and you're averting all the problems related to their bowels, or most of them. Social consideration, unmet needs, hunger, thirst, a need to exercise, a need to move, too much isolation, not enough isolation, too much activity or not enough activity. And sometimes it's just a personality mismatch. There are those individuals that people just don't like. Environmental considerations, I think, are very, very important. The temperature being too hot or too cold. And we can adjust that either with thermostats or blankets. Excuse me. Look at the patient's routine for sleeping and eating and exercise. If the patient likes to walk, if he's in a different setting, they still need to have an avenue to walk, to a pace, to release that energy. And that's something that we don't give them in the acute care setting unless we really have some sensitive nurses that can pick up on it. We had one lady at one of the local nursing homes that when I was going there with one of my medical directors, and this lady was getting up at 3 a.m. every night, between 2 and 3, and she would fall. And so they were trying to figure out what was going on, and they were doing a good job of it because they went through and said, well, she had just come to the nursing home to live. She had been living in her apartment, just barely hanging on with a lot of family support. And what they found out is this was a lady who, at 2 or 3 every morning, used to get up and have a cup of tea and a coffee and a cookie or, something to drink and something to eat. So what they did was they provided that at her bedside at 2 in the morning so that when she woke up, she'd see it right there. She'd sit on the edge of the bed, eat and drink it, and go right back to sleep. So now we've stopped the falling issue very easily and pretty cheaply, too. Ask the family what's calming or agitating for a patient. We have a patient on one of our units the other day. We're lucky enough to have a creative therapist, activity therapist with us now. And one of the things this daughter pointed out right away was her mom loves baby dolls. Well, we've got a whole closet of baby dolls now. And we've got a closet of dogs and a closet of cats and God knows what else. We hide them in our medical director's office. And this lady was thrilled. And she actually had a pretty bad day. And when I saw her, she was quite annoyed and agitated. And she had a very rough morning with the staff. And then when Melissa went up to see her, she went and found her baby doll, but it had been taken away. Well, I knew why it had been taken away. It was because she walloped one of the staff with it. But she was calmer now, so we gave it back to her, and she calmed and brightened right up again. It was a wonderful success story for that therapy. Assess the patient for loneliness, for apathy, for depression. How much stimulus do they like? There are those individuals I've had that they tell me, no matter what, Dad always told us, don't put on classical music if he gets demented or he can't sleep, please. So when you can get things like that from family members, because there's other people, most people kind of consider it, if I'm really wired or something, that's what I always turn on and what we tend to turn on at, for patients at the hospital. We actually are lucky enough now to have I call it the Muzak channel, but it's Muzak view too. It has pictures that just run across that are just like a stream trickling down a mountain, and you just keep watching it, and the wind blows every now and again, and the flowers dip, and then and it goes on with very soft music. And this is very calming for those individuals, especially if I have somebody that now has delirium, whether on top of intact cognition or dementia, that it's almost impossible to interpret or misinterpret this into your delirium and to become more agitated about it. Use of therapeutic activities, music therapy, massage therapy, spiritual care, animal-assisted care has done a marvelous job. We're very lucky to have it at the hospital. And then sleep protocols. One of the things that we're very lucky to have a hospital elder life program, and one of the biggest things it has is a non-pharmacologic sleep protocol. The patient gets either warm milk or herbal tea, they get a hand massage, and they get a relaxation tape. And patients love it. You need to, for an individual who's wandering, you need to make time for regular exercise. You can teach the family to install different locks that require a key. You just have to be sure to teach them that they have to keep it somewhere around so that if there's a fire, y'all can get out. One of the tricks I've used at the hospital, not very recently, but we have in the past, is when we have somebody who wanders a lot and say they have an infection and need to stay in their room for whatever reason, we would get one of the mats that they have when we have rain and they put it by the door, and we'd swipe the worst one and cut it up to look like a hole and put it in front of the door. And if the patient can't interpret it, he'd walk up to the door and then turn around and walk back again. I also used to have Velcro swags that would go across the door, and on it was a stop sign. You know, we learn the stop sign at a very young age, and it kind of has a universal meaning to people. And the gentleman would walk up to the door and look at it, oh, stop, and turn around and walk back again. So he was walking, but it was a non-confrontational way of limiting his activity a little bit more because of his illness. If the patient is at home, the stop signs also work. One of the daycare centers around that I just love, the Family Alzheimer's Day Center, I visited it years ago when it was still in the bottom of Chesterbrook Church over McLean. And one of the things that impressed me so much was what they had was very low-tech stuff. They didn't have alarms on the doors. They didn't have alarms on the window. They had a shower curtain hung across the door so that nobody knew there was a door there. On some of the other doors where people could go in and out, they had a big old school bell, you know, the kind the teachers used to come out and ring when it was time to come in from recess. I'm showing my age, sorry. but it worked because everybody knew to go and redirect that patient to a new area of the facility. And then you can also install a burglar alarm. They can work both ways. If you're concerned about somebody leaving the house unattended that's incapable of caring for themselves, that individual, the door will open once, will alarm once the door is opened, whether somebody's breaking in or breaking out. Okay. I will tell you, we were kind of cackling when somebody said at one of the earlier talks about the patients escaping. We had one patient who came from one of the local nursing homes that has a keypad on their dementia unit, their secure unit. And she was probably not there completely appropriately. And she watched the staff get the code. And so she went up when nobody was around, got a whole bunch of her buddies together. She put in the code and said, come on, we're loose, we can get out now. And so the staff was having a fit. She got moved off the unit right away. An ID band, something like Safe Return from the Alzheimer's and Medical Alert Association, is a wonderful asset and safety measure. And you probably should try and put it on earlier rather than later, especially if this is somebody that's not used to wearing any kind of jewelry, because you need to put it on while they can somewhat understand the need for safe measures and get used to it. And then if somebody is in the home and wandering off, there's also Project Lifesaver. It's used by the, it's through the Sheriff's Department, and they actually can attach a GPS, and I think they can find somebody within a mile, 5 mile radius? 5 mile radius, thank you, I knew you'd know. and so it's an asset that will make the patient safer at home, but still allow them to stay at home. There was one study that was brought to mind by the last speaker that we heard about that was done by the Ideas Company in, I think they're in the Midwest, it's Maggie Calkin. And they looked at the visibility of toilets in various settings and various facilities and the incidences of accidents, incontinence episodes, and the amount of time the person remained continent, and they measured the use of diapers, the number of accidents, and they found that when the patients could directly see the toilet, they got there more frequently. You know, lots of times we have the toilet hidden. So one of the things that I was very happy to see when I was talking about it with my father-in-law was living at Greenspring at the time, and I knew one of the physicians down there, and they were doing renovations, and I shared this with them, and they did the same thing. They did it beautifully. It's very well done, and it did reduce their use of diapers, the reduced incontinence episodes, and more patients were voiding independently, too. The other piece that I always try and teach my family members is that if something happens to you, or you can't take care of him or her anymore, then you may be out of luck. So it's better to take some time now, use some services that are out there, use some respite, take some breaks, so that you can be maintained for the long haul. So you promote and teach self-care, use the Alzheimer's Day programs. You don't have to send somebody there for days and days. Use support groups, accept help from your family, and have a ready list to keep going. In fact, sometimes we create this list before the family member ever leaves the hospital, especially if they're heading straight home, which commonly we do with my older adults that have very advanced dementia because they can't benefit from the rehab. We make a list of what could you tell your, say, the sister comes over to ask, or when the son drops in. Could you have this arranged and say, I'd like you, it'd be a great help if you could, and have it ready for them. Sometimes these family members and caregivers are almost incapacitated by the stress they're under, and you need to give them a little bit of concrete advice and support. So what are the other treatments that we can use for dementia? Okay. First off, you have to individualize the treatment. The cholinesterase inhibitors are probably the first-line drugs that are given. It's donepezil, rivastigmine, and galantamine. Memantine is usually started later on. There are other cognitive enhancers that are tried, and we'll go through them, possibly if the patient has some degree of depression, antidepressant medications. And only as a very last resort and for a very short term would you ever use psychoactive medications. The cholinesterase inhibitors. Aricept has probably, Tacrine's not used, that's the oldest one. It's not even used anymore. I don't think I've seen it in 20 years. Aricept is probably the most common one. Now what we see when we start patients on it is they have some GI upset, and if that happens, all you have to do is go back and start at the beginning again, because you increase it gradually, and double your increase time. So in other words, if you could increase by 5 milligrams every week, make it 5 milligrams every 2 weeks, and lots of times the patients will get to a point that they can tolerate it. Their body just needs that additional time. The cost is about $188 a month. About 13% of patients discontinue. It has some increased syncope, but the biggest thing that we hear is GI upset. Rivastigmine is Exelon. The advantage of Exelon is it also comes in a patch. So if you have somebody that isn't going to take something, you can put it on their back and nobody needs to know about it. Should be done with meals if you're taking it orally. You just put it on once a day after washing the patient if it's the patch. It's more expensive than the Aricept. And more people do discontinue this. The studies that have looked at it are thinking that it might be the cost more than anything else. Galantamine, which is also known as Razadine, is only available orally. And only about 15% discontinue it, and it costs a little bit less than the Exelon, the rivastigmine. Now, a lot of the studies that I've seen were not very positive with regard to these medications and their ability to help the patient with a dementia. What they do, though, is they slow the breakdown of acetylcholine. Clinical trials demonstrate a modest delay in cognitive decline compared with a placebo, and what I read was the average was about 8 months delay in the disease. There are those individuals who, when it's finally recognized or addressed, say to me, well, I'm this far along, what the heck do I want to prolong this for? The other study I saw was that it reduced physical care or assistance with ADLs by 20 minutes per 12-hour shift in the nursing home. And that's kind of a quandary because the patient is in the nursing home to receive care, and they're paying for the nursing home, and now they're paying for the medicine, so they'll need less care while they're there. So there's a little bit of contradiction there. As I said, with the Aricept, it's mitigated by a slow titration up curve, the GI side effects. The maximum dosage now is 23 milligrams per day. There's no evidence of any really significant difference in the efficacy of these medications. The cholinesterase inhibitors, can we use them for everything? Why do we need to figure out what kind of a dementia it is? Because no, they're not indicated in every single setting. Widespread use in vascular dementia is not recommended. You will see it used occasionally because sometimes people have a mixed dementia. Behavioral disturbances in Lewy body dementia have been shown to benefit from treatment with a cholinesterase inhibitor. Rivastigmine is FDA approved for mild to moderate dementia in Parkinson's dementia. When you use these cholinesterase inhibitors, they may actually worsen agitation of frontotemporal dementia. The frontotemporal guys are a conundrum. Lots of things that work in everybody else don't work in them. We'll talk about that. So what do the studies show? JAMA in 2003 looked at 29 studies in a meta-analysis, and they really found very little difference, no real effect of the cholinesterase inhibitors. They looked at 29 studies. There was another meta-analysis in 2003 by the Canadian Medical Journal, and they looked at the clinical global impression of change or clinician's interview-based impression of change plus caregiver input. They really found very minimal improvement in 42 individuals, but there was minimal harm by giving it. About 1 in 16 of the individuals discontinued the medication as a consequence. The Cochrane Review in 2003 looked at 13 studies, and they showed it improved ADAS COG score of 2.7 patients in 6 months. But there were some effects, positive effects, on ADLs and behavior, and that's a biggie for most patients or most caregivers, no matter what the setting. 29% did leave therapy because of adverse results, though. There were fewer side effects from donepezil than from rivastigmine. Okay. The average age in these studies was 72 to 75, which for me is quite young, and a 1 to 4 point improvement on the mini-mental status. So that what they said out of that was the Preventative Services Task Force says 2 to 3 points on the MMSE equals a 2 to 7 month delay in the progression of disease at a year. For Parkinson's disease, rivastigmine was shown to improve cognition 15%. So on the maintenance of ADLs, looking at donepezil, that's Aricept. In 2003, 290 patients were looked at with moderate to severe Alzheimer's dementia. Their Fulstein mini-mental score was between 5 and 17, and it was a 24-week randomized control trial. And it did show a slower decline in ADL scores in those individuals who were treated and 54 minutes less caregiver time per day. Okay. The dropout rate was slightly higher in the donepezil group, though, than in the placebo group. So, what's the summary? The small benefit: some of the patients may show improvement. Some patients may have progression delayed. There's no benefit to taking more than one cholinesterase inhibitor at a time, and Aricept is probably the better tolerated of all the medications. Okay. Memantine is an NMDA agonist. It is a neuroprotective effect is to reduce glutamate-mediated excitotoxicity. It shows a modest benefit on cognition, ADLs, and behavior in Alzheimer's dementia. It is FDA approved for moderate to severe Alzheimer's dementia. It can cause constipation, dizziness, and headache. So what are some of the other things, though, that are out there? Those alternative methods, okay? There are aspirin that have been looked at, statins have been looked at, ginkgo biloba has been looked at, selegiline, vitamin E, estrogen, and NSAIDs. So how did they fare? Okay. Vitamin E may lower rates of decline, but there was no evidence of cognitive improvement once you had already developed Alzheimer's dementia. And it is no longer recommended due to the evidence of increased mortality if you do increase mortality with the high-dose supplementation. Selegiline may slow the rate of decline, but there was no evidence of cognitive improvement. Ginkgo biloba was shown to offer no benefit at all. Okay. Antidepressants they improved depressed mood, they improved appetite occasionally, they helped insomnia, but they did not really affect the progression of the disorder. However, they did show some good effect based on the drug chosen with regard to the symptoms you were treating. And behavioral disturbances, that's one thing that has already been brought up clearly before, are always best managed non-pharmacologically by reducing, treating the environmental stimuli and doing environmental modification, keeping the patient homeostatically sound, and allowing them to move around. Okay. First and second generation antipsychotics really have shown limited efficacy and increased risk of all-cause mortality and dementia. They should really be used with very great caution when we're targeting delusions, hallucinations, and paranoia. And really, if somebody needs to go on them, they need to be frequently tapered off. They need to use them for the shortest time and at the lowest dose. Valproic acid and carbamazepine have been shown to have a little bit of effect, predominantly on frontotemporal dementia. Benzodiazepines and anticholinergic medications should almost always be avoided in the older adult. We did see an uptick in the amount of Ativan being prescribed in patients coming from nursing homes after the black box warnings came out on the antipsychotics, and we found patients were more sedated and were falling more. There actually has also been a study out in December, I believe, of 2012 from the Mayo Clinic on Ambien, which is commonly given to older adults as completely contraindicated. It was an independent risk factor after everything else was controlled for falls. And the difference in the falls rate with and without Ambien after control was 0.78 for non-Ambien patients for falls, and it was like 3.2 for patients with Ambien after everything else was controlled for. Maintaining ADLs is very important in our older adults. It's going to take more time, and that's the reason it doesn't get done lots of times. Lay out the clothes, but you don't have to dress the person as long as they can dress themselves. Timed and prompted voiding can decrease checks for wetness by 50%. Avoid disruptions in routine. I often have families that there's, you know, one daughter in California and one here, and they take turns taking care of mom, but instead of them moving, they move mom, who's got advanced dementia and can't figure out where she is at any given time. And in reality, if we were going to treat the patient optimally, the daughters would swap houses for a period of time to give them the break. if patients are wandering, consider increasing exercise, using daycare, registration with Safe Return we talked about, Project Lifesaver. Believe it or not, there has been one or two studies I've seen with chip implantation now for people who are at high risk of wandering. It's really ethically controversial. For fire risk, if you're concerned, unplug the phone, unplug the stove. For falls, get physical therapy in. For gait disturbances, resistant training. Even patients with dementia will do activities and exercise if they have the one-on-one attention they need. Pill boxes and locking up medications. Probably one of the hardest things I see is when people are trying to maintain independence and the person really cannot manage their medications anymore, no matter how many different things we put in. And they're very high risk with these medications. Okay. When you're looking at pharmacologic options to treat the behaviors of dementia, you want to identify the target so that you're being very specific and very patient focused. And mood stabilizers commonly are very, very well tolerated and less sedating. Antidepressants, citalopram had the most evidence of improvement. Of the atypical antipsychotics when they needed to be used, olanzapine only had modest benefit but increased risk of stroke. Risperidone had a pretty good response and was able to be tapered off more quickly. Many times people also give my older adults IMs because they don't want to bother them with an IV. IM is intramuscular, it's a shot in your rear end or your shoulder, for those of you that are not clinicians. my older adults have, their muscle mass is too erratic. It's not absorbed correctly when we give medications IM. If we can't give them IV, because you're not in the hospital, if they won't take pills, there are most medications come in a version that's liquid, an oral solution that's liquid, and you can give them sublingually, and it's much less invasive for the patient. There is risk of death that's increased. That's the black box warning with antipsychotic drugs. The risk increases with the different drugs. The lowest risk is PO Haldol, oral Haldol, believe it or not. And we have tons of people that like the Seroquel, but the lowest risk is oral Haldol. And we give it when we have to give it for delirium at the hospital, 0.25 scheduled every 12 hours. So it's a tiny, tiny bit, and then if the patient does fine, as soon as they're back to normal, you just taper them back off of it. Dementia is extremely common in the older adult, but it's not an inherent part of aging. Evaluation includes the informant, physical and functional assessment, focus labs, possibly brain imaging. The primary treatment goals, though, should always be to improve that person's quality of life. How you can maximize their function, their cognition, their mood, and their behavior. And sometimes medications are involved, especially if it's going to slow down a progressive disease process. But you should always not go to them as the first line. You should use non-pharmacologic first. We all want to have happy aging, healthy aging, and the way to do it is to be up and moving and heart-healthy eating right now. Questions?
Which drugs were you talking? I mean, you were saying yes, no. I'm like, what?
What I was saying was that this is how a way to look at individualizing and making it very specific to the individual person. It helps you, what is the target behavior or issue that you're looking for? If it's that Mrs. Jones is crying every afternoon and you can't find any non-pharmacologic intervention that will work, possibly you may need to give some medication that has an anxiolytic effect. I usually don't recommend the benzodiazepines, which are normally what we would give to most people in this room for anxiety. But there are some other medications that have that a bit of that anxiety-alytic effect. If they're having a poor appetite or losing weight, one of the big things we use now is very tiny doses of Remeron, which is an antidepressant. But it's a safer sleeper, and it does stimulate appetite. So it's safer than all the sleepers, and it's probably safer than the Megace we give people who aren't eating well, which predisposes them to vascular disorders and clots. That kind of, does that help? Yes.
You talked a lot about the drugs and the effect and non-effect. Are there times you don't give those drugs at all? That's one question. The second thing is we had our first conference 2 years ago and it was on chronic disease management and all the comorbidities. And many of these patients have 20 to 30 drugs. How do you manage that in your assessment and planning? Do you reduce some? Do you leave them all and just put yours on? Well, and then lastly, you know that often Alzheimer's is a terminal disease, and as Paul said, you're doing habilitation, not rehabilitation. Does that change your practice in any way?
Absolutely. And that was why I brought up at the very beginning that this is a terminal illness. And it's treated as a terminal illness, but many people don't recognize it, but it needs to be treated that way. Okay, your first question, no, it was the second one, about all the medicines. We try and clean up medicines whenever, that's part of our consult service, is to get rid of things that are not needed or no longer effective. If I have a 98-year-old that's on 2 cholesterol-lowering medicines, like, throw them out the window. She clearly has outlived her cholesterol. But you also look at, and it's something I've learned from the hospice nurses as well, is the pill burden. You know, there are some medications that you're balancing the risk and the benefit, and yes, you'd love to have this under perfect control, but is it really going to benefit the patient and the amount of time it takes to get, not because you don't have it, but the distress it causes the patient to get it into them. Does that make sense? Yeah. And it is fine also to say with the, whether it's the cholinesterase inhibitors or the NMD agonists, The effect is so minimal. I have, on most patients, there are a few patients I've seen a dramatic response, and I would not stop it on them. On most other patients, as the disease advances, it's fine to stop it. I stopped it on my mom pretty early on.
Thank you.
There was a third question, though, but I don't remember
what it was. Well, it was just, do you ever not give those drugs to, because of the limited effect in the condition, and you just said in your mom's case or in other cases, you might not, because it seems like the pharmacological industry is...
It's out of control.
And yet at the bedside or at the home, you know, there's, if it's not benefiting, you know, you have to weigh that. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I'm getting a time here. Is there one more question? Can I take one more? One more.
What were the two pain scales that you mentioned?
I'm sorry, I didn't...
The names of the two pain scales that you mentioned earlier in your
pain
talk?
Pain AD, so PAIN-AD, and the other one is the nonverbal pain indicators, NVPI. Thank you all very much.